Episode 5, Acute Respiratory Distress Syndrome. This is a very important topic and one of the most common complications, I would say, to be encountered in post-operative period. And all the discussion regarding ventilators and ABG, you will see that it is very useful in managing the acute respiratory distress syndrome. Now, how to define acute respiratory distress syndrome? First and most important criteria is it should be acute in onset. So there should not be underlying chronic lung pathology. Either it is acute on chronic or acute but never chronic. Chest X-ray should have bilateral inflammatory infiltrates. Bilateral infiltrates, to be very precise. Now, this bilateral infiltrate can take some time. So, for early diagnosis of acute respiratory distress syndrome, sometimes bilateral infiltrates are not required. But you need to see that there is no clinical evidence of left heart failure or fluid overload. Now, how to define, and this is the most important criteria to define acute respiratory distress syndrome on ABG. Now, when your PaO2 to FiO2 ratio is less than or equal to 300, you defined it as an acute lung injury. Now, when acute lung injury converts into acute respiratory distress syndrome, when your PaO2 to FiO2 ratio falls down to less than or equal to 200, or the same criteria is saturation to FiO2 ratio less than or equal to 315 for acute lung injury, and saturation to FiO2 ratio of less than 235 for acute respiratory distress syndrome. Now, what is Berlin definition of acute respiratory distress syndrome? Now, Berlin definition is endorsed by European Society of Intensive Care Medicine, American Thoracic Society and Society of Critical Care Medicine. Basically, they divided acute respiratory distress syndrome in three types: mild, moderate, and severe. And they took into account various things: timing, chest imaging, origin of edema, and oxygenation. So let us see what is the Berlin definition. Berlin definition of acute respiratory distress syndrome, taken from this paper published in JAMA, that is, should develop within 1 week of a known clinical insult, or it should be a new or worsening respiratory symptoms. Chest imaging should have bilateral opacity, not fully explained by effusion, lobar lung collapse, or nodules. What is the origin of edema? Respiratory failure should not fully explained by cardiac failure or fluid overload, as I have discussed in first slide. It needs objective assessment. Overload or cardiac failure, absence of cardiac failure should be documented by echo to exclude hydrostatic edema or edema due to pressure differences in cardiac chambers. Now, mild acute respiratory distress syndrome is defined when your PaO2 FiO2 ratio is between 200 to 300 with PEP pressure on ventilator more than or equal to 5 cm of H2O. Moderate is defined when your PaO2 FiO2 ratio is 100 mmHg with PEP pressure more than or equal to 5 cm of H2O. Severe is defined when PaO2 FiO2 ratio is less than 100 mmHg with PEP pressure greater than or equal to 5 cm of H2O. Now, what are the causes of ARDS? 35% of cases it is due to pneumonia and is one of the most common cause. 15% cases is aspiration. 26% you will see in sepsis, severe sepsis or septic shock. 11% in trauma, and 13% include pancreatitis, pulmonary embolism, smoke inhalation. So if you analyze this chart, you will see that pneumonia is common post-operative complication, aspiration is common post-operative complication, severe sepsis is common post-operative complication, pancreatitis every time surgeons deal with, pulmonary embolism is one of the common causes of post-operative complication. So as a surgeon, either many of time we deal with ARDS or our patient developed ARDS as a consequences of other complications. Now, what are the differential diagnoses? All, it should not be volume overload, it should not be a cardiac condition like mitral stenosis or LVS. Other differentials are pulmonary embolism, pulmonary veno-occlusive diseases. Other is lymphagenic spread of malignancy, and other rare causes of acute eosinophilic pneumonia, acute intestinal pneumonitis, hypersensitive pneumonia. What is the pathophysiology? Whenever there is a direct or indirect injury to alveolus, it certainly causes alveolar macrophages to release various pro-inflammatory cytokines. These cytokines attract neutrophils into alveolus and interstitium, where they damage alveolar capillary membrane and gas exchange gets affected. So, alveolar capillary membrane integrity is lost. Interstitium and alveolus fills with proteinaceous fluid or edema fluid or inflammatory fluid. Surfactant can no longer support alveolus. And what are the consequences of this lung injury? It causes impaired gas exchange. Due to inflammatory exudates, it decreases compliance. So lung cannot expand properly. At the same time, it increases pulmonary arterial pressure. So, impaired gas exchange causes ventilation perfusion mismatch. It is related to either due to filling of alveoli, or sometimes shunting can also cause hypoxemia. So basically, due to that, hypoxemia occurs. It increases dead place due to increased fluid, and it increases capillary dead place and ventricular perfusion mismatch. So, due to this dead places, it impairs carbon dioxide elimination. It results in high minute ventilation due to increased dead place. So basically, it causes hypoxemia as well as it can cause hypercarbia. Decreased compliance is a hallmark of ARDS. They are also known as the stiff lungs. It is due to stiffness of poorly or non-irrigated lungs, fluid-filled lungs. And it requires increased pressure via ventilator to deliver required tidal volume. And that is why to maintain blood oxygenation level becomes very difficult. Also, in ARDS, there is increased pulmonary arterial pressure, and it can be seen in almost 25% of the patient. It results from hypoxic vasoconstriction. Plus, positive airway pressure from ventilator, it causes vascular compression. It can result in right ventricular failure. So, and generally, we do not routinely measure pulmonary arterial pressure. Reason we will discuss in subsequently. So, what is the evidence-based management of ARDS? Of course, first is you need to treat underlying cause. Treat pneumonia, treat sepsis, treat pulmonary embolism, treat pancreatitis. Second key is low tidal volume ventilation. Use end expiratory pressure optimally. We will discuss each of these things in detail. Always monitor airway pressures, that is plateau pressures and etc. Conservative fluid management helps. And of course, try to reduce potential complications. Now, from my talk on ventilator, I think you are now well aware with tidal volumes and various ventilator pressures. So, various studies, and this study is published in New England Journal of Medicine, showed that low tidal volume ventilation is helpful in acute lung injury. So, their hypothesis was in acute lung injury, ventilation was with smaller tidal volumes will result in better clinical outcomes than the traditional tidal volume. Smaller tidal volumes are defined as 6 ml per kg, traditional is 12 ml per kg of ventilation. Now, they found that when compared to larger tidal volumes, lower tidal volumes of idle body weight decrease mortality, it increases number of ventilator free days, it decreases extrapulmonary organ failure, and mortality is decreased in low tidal volume group despite these patients may be having worse oxygenation. they always showed increased PCO2. They were more acidotic than the usual patient. So, do not get bothered if your patient is little bit of high PCO2. If you can maintain oxygenation target that we will discuss subsequently between 88 to 92% of oxygen saturation, 88 or 91 doesn't make any difference. So, if your tidal volumes can give you 88, low tidal volume can give you 88% of saturation, that is adequate. And little bit of acidosis in body is acceptable in ARDS. Now see at this CT, why this low tidal volume ventilation is useful. ARDS affects lungs in heterogeneous fashion. That means each area of lung may behave differently or each alveoli may behave differently. As you can see in the first arrow, normal alveoli will show the normal ventilation. Then there can be some alveoli which are injured, but they are still do not filled with completely with fluid and they still participate in gas exchange. So these injured alveoli can potentially participate in a gas exchange, but they are susceptible to damage from opening and closing due to high tidal volumes. And damaged alveoli are already gone. They are filled with fluid, they do not participate in gas exchange. Opening them are not very much useful sometimes. So in this cases, due to this heterogeneous picture, low tidal volume ventilation protects to avoid over distension of normal alveoli. It protects the injured alveoli from damaging further. It minimizes airway pressure and you can optimize PEP to deliver adequate air to the normal alveoli. Now, we have discussed about the what should be the ventilator settings of tidal volume. Now, let us study about the PEEP or positive end expiratory pressure. This study compared higher versus lower positive end expiratory pressure in patient with acute respiratory distress syndrome. So in this NEGM paper, they studied higher versus lower positive end expiratory pressure in patient with acute respiratory distress syndrome. And their hypothesis was in patient with acute lung injury or ARDS, ventilated with low tidal volume, 6 ml per kg, higher level of PEP resulted in better clinical outcome than lower level of PEP. Now, higher level of PEP versus FiO2 ratio does not improve outcome and may negatively impact outcome. So here, not only you require higher PEP, but higher PEP FiO2 ratio also. What I mean is your PEP should be high, but PEP FiO2 ratio should not be high. What it means, you have to increase your PEP with each increase in your FiO2 levels, because higher level of PEP FiO2 ratio may negatively impact outcome, because it can cause increase of airway pressure and barotrauma. It can increase dead play because your FiO2 is at lower level. So percentage of oxygen in the breathing volume is very less and you are delivering with higher pressure. So optimal oxygen may not reach the target alveoli. So it can cause increased airway pressure. It can increase dead space because percentage of oxygen in more air is less. It can decrease venous return and of course it can cause barotrauma. And we all know that lung is stiff and fibrotic in case of ARDS. Their compliance is very less. So we need higher pressures. But at the same time, we need higher FiO2 for each increase in pressure. Our goal is to maximize alveolar recruitment and prevent cycles of recruitment de-recruitment. That means every alveoli should work optimally in every condition. Now this study compared various ventilation strategies using low tidal volume, various recruitment maneuvers and high PEP for acute lung injury and acute distress syndrome. They studied 983 patients randomized into control group with ALI protocol, that is low tidal volume, high PEP pressure. Versus open lung, low tidal volume, higher PEP and recruitment maneuvers. So there was no statistically significant difference between the both group and mortality outcome. So if you studied both the group using low tidal volume, higher PEP, so we are not sure various recruitment maneuvers like changing the ventilator parameters or keeping patient in the prone position helps or not, but many studies do show benefit due to that. This is another study where PEP pressure in adult with acute lung injury and ARDS, they have studied 767 patients. Set a PEP or positive end expiratory pressure aim to increase the alveolar recruitment while limiting hyperinflation. They randomly assigned two groups, that is one group with moderate PEP, that is 5 to 9 cm H2O, versus level of PEP to reach the maximum plateau pressure, that is 28 to 30 cm H2O. As we have studied in basics of mechanical ventilation section, that maximum plateau pressure should be 30 cm H2O. More than that, there are high chances of barotrauma. They also found that it didn't significantly reduce mortality, but patient with higher PEP improved lung function and decreased days on ventilator and organ failure duration. So higher PEP is very much important to improve lung function, and you can also reduce the days on ventilator. And as I said, PEP FiO2 ratio should not be increased very much. So every increase in FiO2, you should try to increase your PEP. So if your FiO2 is 0.3 or 30%, your PEP should be 5.45, 0.45, 0.58, 0.5. But as you increase, you can see the PEP should be increasing, so that PEP FiO2 ratio is not altered very much. This is also known as the ARDS net protocol, and which is the most popular nowadays. So whenever you are managing a patient of ARDS, he is not maintaining oxygenation. Say for example, your saturation is a 70-78 and you tend to increase FiO2. Never increase FiO2 alone. You need to increase PEP up to the limit of 30 cm of H2O of plateau pressure. Plateau pressure you have to measure when by putting the ventilator machine in the inspiratory hold, as discussed in previous episode. Now let's discuss about various airway pressure in ARDS. As we discussed, plateau pressure is the most predictive of lung injury. Goal of plateau pressure should be less than 30, lower the better, but you can increase up to 30, because lower plateau pressure decreases the alveolar overdistension and reduces the risk of lung strain and barotrauma. Adjust tidal volume to ensure your plateau pressure as a goal. It may be permissible to have plateau pressure more than 30 in some cases, morbidly obese patient, in pregnancy, or whenever you are treating a liver disease patient or ascitic patient. If your plateau pressure is high, you need to differentiate. What are the causes? Most common causes in ARDS is stiff, non-compliant lung. Or can also be heart failure. Other causes are pneumothorax. Auto peeping is a ventilator glitch, and I am not going into detail. You can read on net or from your books. Another is mucus plug in endotracheal tube, or your intubation is on the right side. Your patient may be having compartment syndrome, or there is high chest wall fat or obesity. This cough, we have discussed in ventilator episodes also, that respiratory cough is like this. Peak inspiratory pressure is the pressure required to inflate lung fully during the inspiration, but it will also include airway resistance, that is the dead space resistance. Plateau pressure is the actual pressure required to inflate the lung. So that is the peak inspiratory pressure minus resistive pressure, that is the dead space pressure. And PIP is the pressure delivered at the end of expiration and starting of new inspiration. Now another controversy is whether pulmonary artery catheter guided fluid therapy or central venous catheter guided fluid therapy is helpful or not. Various studies have shown that routine pulmonary artery or catheter pressure or pulmonary artery or pressure measurement is not necessary in ALA. So now it is decreasing in practice, and every study says that you should use a conservative fluid strategy in patient with acute lung injury, that will be known as the dry lung. However, patient fluid balance should not be in a very negative state, because when you go for over conservative therapy, there increase of chances of other organ failures, because your patient is dehydrated, other organ may not get adequate oxygenation. So it should be balanced between overhydrate and underhydrate. Your patient should be hydrated adequately. As we said, that pulmonary artery catheter placement or measurement did not alter survival, did not improve organ function, did not change outcome of patient entering shock compared to those without shock, and PSE use resulted in more non-fatal complication, and mostly arrhythmias are very common with pulmonary artery catheterization. Now let us compare the two fluid management strategy, that is fluid restriction versus normal fluid, or dry lung versus wet lung. Now hypothesis was that diuresis and fluid restriction may improve lung function but could jeopardize extrapulmonary organ perfusion. It concluded after studying everything that conservative fluid management improved lung function and shortened mechanical ventilation time, ICUD, without increasing non-pulmonary organ failure. Here again, I want to define conservative fluid management is CVP less than 4 mmHg, but at that same time, your patient should not be dry too much, that patient is not taking orally, you are not giving IV fluid, and patient is producing lots of urine. In those cases, there are chances of other organ failure. So keep your lung dry adequately, not over dry it, because increased fluid can increase lung water, and it is the underlying cause of many clinical abnormalities in ARDS. It can decrease compliance, it can help in poor gas exchange, atelectasis after resolution of shock. So first you should treat shock, and shock requires fluid. So you cannot say, no, my patient is having ARDS, so I will not give fluid, but your patient is having septic shock and requires fluid. So whenever patient requires fluid, you should give fluid. But when your patient is recovering from shock or did not have shock, just conserve your fluid. And you should attempt in a negative fluid balance size. It helped in shortened times of ventilator and ICU length of stay. So when fluid is needed, you have to give it, but when you can avoid it, avoid it. Now in severe ARDS, you have to keep your patient in a prone position, because as shown in this study, early application of prolonged prone positioning significantly decreased 28 day and 90 day mortality in patient with severe ARDS. What do you mean by severe ARDS? Your PaO2 FiO2 ratio should be less than 100. Now what are the weaning protocol for ARDS patient? It is same as standard weaning protocol. Your FiO2 should be less than 40. Your PEP pressure should be less than 8. Patient had acceptable spontaneous breathing efforts. No vasopressure requirement. Your PIP whenever should be 5. Your respiratory rate is less than 25 when you are pressure support weaning. That is, you can decrease your PEP level. If patient is not tolerating this, you can increase the respiratory rate, decrease vital tidal volume and return to ARDS protocol or return to assist control mode. If your patient is on TPs and tolerate TPs from 30 minutes to 2 hours, your patient is ready for weaning. Generally, more than 2 hours of TPs is not required. Many times we see patients on TPs from morning to afternoon or morning to evening. These are not required. If your patient can tolerate TPs from 30 minutes to 2 hours, that depends on your ICU settings or ICU staff training and many other things. But generally, between 30 to 2 hours is adequate time for weaning. Another criteria is, here your saturation goal should be more than equal to 90. That means you don't require those 99% of saturation that we are running madly after. Patient should be maintaining on tidal volume less than equal to 4 ml per kg. This is when patient is tolerating breathing tire. If patient respiratory rate is less than equal to 35, that is okay. Do not aim for 17, 18. Many times we get a call from ICU. Sir, patient is having tachypnea, but actually respiratory rate is just 28. So 28 to 30 is okay. Your pH should be more than 7.3. Patient should pass spontaneous awakening test. Patient should pass spontaneous breathing index that we have discussed in last episode. Patient should not have respiratory distress. Now, what you define by respiratory distress? Two or more of above below criteria. Whenever your patient is having tachycardia, that is more than 120 of heart rate, patient is using accessory muscles, patient is having abdominal paradox, patient is having marked dyspnea and uncomfortable, diaphoresis, patient is sweating like anything. If those features are not there, you have to consider extubation also. So let us summarize. First step in treating patient with ARDS is calculating patient's predicted body weight. That can be calculated by following definition, because your tidal volume, PEP, respiratory rate, everything is according to body weight. Then set tidal volume on ventilator, that is predicted body weight, into 6 cc, that is 6 ml per kg. Set initial respiratory rate approximately baseline by minute ventilation. So that is generally 12 to 14. But if with that also your ABG showed increased CO2, then increase the respiratory rate a little bit. Set FiO2 and PEP to obtain saturation goal of more than 88%. So again, 99% madness is not required. First, treat shock. If you need to give fluid, give fluid. But after resolution of shock, you can give diuretics sometimes or decrease your fluid balance and keep patient in negative balance. So you cannot keep patient in negative balance or restrict fluid too much when your patient is in shock. When your patient is not in shock, decrease your fluid balance. And you can refer it to ARDS NET guidelines. Those are widely available on NET. Now, common problem you will find, if your plateau pressure is more than 30, then immediately decrease the tidal volume by 1 cc per kg, and you can reduce it up to 4 cc per kg of ideal body weight or predicted body weight. Ensure that there is no pneumothorax, autopep, or other reason to acute change in compliance. Whenever there is a ventilator patient dyssynchrony, Plato is less than 30, you can increase vital tidal volume by 1 cc per kg up to 8 cc of kg, ensuring every time your Plato pressure is less than 30. You can increase your inspiratory flow rate and give sedation or neuromuscular blocker to knock off patient, and that will prevent your ventilator patient desynchrony. In case of hypotension, you have to give volume, as I said repeatedly. Don't go by, oh, it's ARDS, so we need to conserve fluid and let us not give volume. In case of hypotension, you have to give volume. You ensure that there is no pneumothorax. Evaluate whether there is auto-peeping is happening or not. Decrease sedation if possible when patient is in hypotensive. There is a sedation score known as the Richmond scale or RAS scale. Search on net and keep that score between minus 1 or 0. If your pH is less than 7.30, you can increase the respiratory rate up to 35. If your pH is less than 7.5, increase respiratory rate up to 35, and whenever your pH is less than 7.15, you have to give bicarb. Otherwise, there is no role of bicarb. If your hypoxia is still not improving, give neuromuscular blockage. Check whether the tube in the ventilator and patient, there is no block, circuit is okay. Various recruitment maneuver, you can keep your patient in prone position. Increase PEEP up to the Plato pressure of 30. Some benefit with inhaled epoprostenol sodium or Flolan. And sometimes you have to give high frequency ventilation or higher ventilation. Basically, this is same as higher rate ventilation. And as I said, that neuromuscular blocking agent may increase oxygenation and decrease ventilator associated lung injury. And this study from any GM support it. Of course, you have to continue the supportive therapies like treat underlying cause, underlying infection. You have to give DVT prophylaxis. Keep your head end of your patient 30 degree elevated. It prevents aspiration. Whenever patient is on ventilator, we forget to do that. And patient is lying. Of course, you have to keep aseptic precaution like hand washing, use full barrier with chlorhexidine, sedation analgesia. As I said, you should maintain your Richmond scale between 0 to minus 1. Nutrition is very important. So you should have feeding protocol, whether ice tube should be in place or not. Avoid too much of contrast and contrast into acute kidney injury that we have discussed in our episode 2. Then routine pressure ulcer prevention. You have to turn patient every 2 hourly. And avoid steroid use. Why? Because earlier it was believed that in ARDS, hydrocort or steroids helpful. But many of the studies are coming out that steroids are not very helpful on survival. So you should avoid as long as possible. So, and this study regarding steroid concluded that recovery is dependent on health prior to onset. If your patient recovered within 6 months, patient will have maximum recovery. 1 year post extubation, more than 1/3 of patients have normal spirometry. Of course, due to prolonged ICU stay, prolonged ventilator stay, these patients may have, or they are susceptible to post-traumatic stress disorder, depressions, and other psychological problems. Various lung protective ventilation are coming up that we have already discussed. And those are the main form of treatment in ARDS. Thank you very much. If you have any question, you can always put in a comment section and I will try to answer each and every one. Thank you.